437 in your hymnal, 437. Since the Savior found me, pardoned all my sin. Once you find that, if you'll stand with me, we'll sing, saved, saved, saved. On that first together. Since the Savior found me, pardoned all my sin, I have had the joy and living hope within. Gone is all the shame and sorrow of the past. There underneath the precious blood of Christ at last. Save, 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 I'm happy all the way. Save, save, save,
I love the glory's
name. Save, 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 I know he's mighty charm. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by his power. Since the Savior found me, all to him I owe. For his precious blood has washed me white as snow. Now no condemnation, happy as can be. I'm glad that Jesus justifies and sets me free. I'm saved, saved, saved.
I'm happy all the way.
Saved, saved, saved. I love him more each day. Saved, saved, saved. I know his mighty power. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by his power. Since the Savior found me, I have perfect rest, living in the realms of joy and happiness, leaning on my Savior, looking for that day when he shall come to catch his waiting bride away. I'm saved, 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 I'm happy all the way. Saved, 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 I love him more each day. Saved, 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 I know he's mighty charm. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by his power.
All right, good singing tonight. And always good to come and sing about being saved, isn't it? And you just, we take it for granted sometimes. But boy, when you think about more than half the world has never even heard about Jesus, and you're saved. You don't hear about him. You knew who he was, and you explained what he did for you, and you accepted him as your Savior. I'm glad I'm saved, and praise the Lord for that. It's only his grace. It's what he's done. You'd be on the other side of the world somewhere in a country that you'd never know about Jesus, and so thank him for that. Praise the Lord. Good to see you back tonight. Hope you had a good afternoon. Looking forward to a good service together this evening. Let's start with prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for, as the writer of Hebrews said, a great salvation.
Yes.
Lord, that certainly was only in the mind of God that you would conceive such a plan, that you would give your only begotten Son to die in our place. And Lord, we want to tell you we love you this evening. We ask you to meet with us here tonight. Give us what we need in this service, Lord. You know the needs of our heart. And I pray you'd meet the needs of the hearts of the people that are in this room tonight. Make this service, the songs, the fellowship, the preaching, make it exactly what you need it to be and what you desire it to be, and use it in our lives. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
355 in your hymnal, 355. Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. 355, let's sing that first together. Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. How shall my tongue describe it? Where shall its praise begin? Taking away setting my spirit free, for the wonderful grace of Jesus, it reaches. Grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea. Wonderful grace, all sufficient for me. Broader than the scope of my transgression, greater far than all my sin and shame. Oh, magnify the precious of Jesus, reaching to all the lost. torn asunder, giving me liberty for that wonderful grace of Jesus reaches me. Wonderful the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea. Wonderful grace of
announcements now. And remember, this week, Wednesday night, midweek service, 7 o'clock as usual. And we'll be right here in the children's clubs and everything going on as normal on Wednesday night at 7. Saturday will be men's breakfast, 8:15. Fellas, come on out and enjoy the breakfast this coming Saturday morning and the fellowship together. Soul winning and bus visitation at 10 a.m. as usual on Saturday. And then, of course, we look forward to next Sunday services. Monday, the 23rd, will be the ladies' night out. And there's a sign-up sheet for those things down in the foyer. And then Tuesday of that week, the 24th, Grove City School of the Bible kicks off. So things will start rolling here again as we hit 2017, and it's going to be a great, great time. All right? And remember to be filling in your quarters and dollar folders. We do have more quarter folders now. The ushers have them in their cabinet back there. If you need one, just ask one of them, and they'll get you the folders to fill the quarters in for the Bibles. Brother Yoder, I had not told Brother Yoder about that. He found out this morning when he came. He said, "You're collecting money for Bibles?" And he's pretty excited about that. So it's great. So I can't wait for that to see that take place. We got to have them take some video of that so we can see the reaction of people when they get their Bibles. I think that would be outstanding. So that'll be great. All right. Take a moment and see if anybody's visiting with us this evening. I'm looking around. Anybody here tonight for the first time? I didn't think I saw any first timers. All right. Let's hear from the choir.
Thank you. Let's go over to 78, please. Number 78, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. You can remain seated and we sing on that first together. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his in the mansion bright and blessed. He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. On that third, let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. On that last, onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Well, we have an anniversary to celebrate. Xavier and Felicia's anniversary. Wow, that got some woos already. And let's see, I think it was January 14th. Is that right? Wonderful. Come on up here. We want to help you celebrate your anniversary. How many years, Xavier? 5 years. Oh, what's five? That's like nothing, isn't it? I mean, we're just getting broke in, huh? Yeah, that is five anything? Is that wood? All right. Well, we have flowers for. Give you something to hold while you're. She has flowers, and we. Yeah, he said, that's, I'll just hold her, amen. Appreciate so much, Xavier and Felicia. What a wonderful couple this is, and God's going to do some great things with them, and we're excited. This is an exciting year for them. They do have a survey trip planned, I think, for this summer to Siberia. Is that right? Siberia. You they don't have summer in Siberia. I got news for you. But again, that's where. That and again, this is one of the situations where family members say, "Well, how did you choose that?" You know, well, they didn't choose it. God does the choosing. God does the calling, and that's where he feels like the Lord is leading them. And so, pray for them, would you? And encourage them. And exciting to see what the Lord's going to do. I believe with all my heart. I've said it before. I think God sent them to us so we could send them out from us. And he's using this time to prepare them for the work he's going to do in them. We're glad to celebrate 5-year anniversary with them tonight. Let's sing to them, all right? Wonderful. Congratulations. Take your song, number 91, songbook number 91. What a day, glorious day that will be. There's coming a day. Let's stand together and sing it. Number 91, please, Brother Bob.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky. No more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Let's sing that last together. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burden to bear. Amen. When we get to that chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. We'll sing that a cappella. On that last, there'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day.
Be seated. That is great. Man, going to make a CD of you singing here if you keep that up. That's great singing. We were talking about that this morning with somebody, that how we miss that. We sing, what a day, glorious day that'll be. And then we have testimonies and we say, well, I want to thank the Lord for waking me up this morning. Yeah, but if he didn't, you'd be in heaven. Amen. So you're saying, I thank the Lord I'm still here on earth rather than being in heaven? There's nobody in heaven who says that, amen? There's nobody in heaven that says, boy, he didn't wake me up today. Huh? Oh, no, you wake up in heaven. How great would that be? I may be a little tough for people who leave behind, I know. But, you know, somebody said, would you miss us if you're in heaven? Well, not for long, you wouldn't. You're not thinking about the people on earth. You'd be so. You imagine what it's going to be like? I can't imagine that. What a day that'll be. And sometimes we miss out on that. But good singing tonight. Enjoyed it very much. Let's pray and we'll ask God's blessing on the offering night. Brother McKeon, lead us in prayer, would you?
Let's pray. Father, thank you for the day. Thank you for the opportunity we have to come and worship you and learn about you, Lord. And thank you for the opportunity we have to give back a portion of what you've given to us and blessed us with. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Lisa. Take your Bible this evening, if you would, to Isaiah 40. Isaiah chapter 40, please, for our scripture reading. Isaiah 40. We're going to read verses 27 through 31. Verses 27 through 31. Reading them responsively, as we normally do. We begin on 27 and alternate till we end together on verse 31. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture, all of us standing to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 27 of Isaiah chapter 40. Ready? Why sayest thou, O Jacob, and speakest, O Israel, my way is hid from the Lord, and my judgment is passed over from my God? Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might he increaseth strength. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing to the reading of the scripture here this evening. And Father, I thank you so much for the wonderful music tonight. Lord, it's just been a joy to be in the house of God this evening. Thank you for each one who's made their way here tonight. And Lord, I pray that you'll bless the special, that it will continue to prepare our heart and tune our heart to your heart, that we'll hear the Spirit of God, the voice of your Spirit speaking to each of us this evening. And give us help from your word as only you can do. And I'll thank you for it. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
When the race still lies before me, and the wind is blowing strong, when the witnesses around me, and my strength is almost gone, when the valley plunges deeper, and life shatters all my dreams, then I lift my voice to Jesus, and he gives my spirit wings. God gives wings as eagles. God gives wings to fly and strength to rise above. God gives wings as eagles. When my feet begin to stumble and my dreams begin to crumble, I mount up on eagle's wings. Let us run the race with patience. Let us lay each weight aside. Looking only unto Jesus, he will be our faithful guide. He has run the race before us. He has won the victor's crown. And he calls for every Christian, follow me to higher crown. God gives wings as eagles. God gives wings to fly and strength to rise above. God gives wings as eagles. When my feet begin to stumble and my dreams begin to crumble, I mount up on eagle's wings. I mount up.
Good, Bob. Now, our Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer, and we thank you, Lord, for your word tonight. And Father, I'm asking you to once again honor the preaching of your word. It pleases you through the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. And so, Father, I bow before you here, and I pray that each one of us would yield ourselves to you. And I pray, God, that your Holy Spirit would have his way in each one of our hearts and lives. Please help me as I bring this message this evening, Lord. Give me clarity of thought. Help us to be able to focus on your word this evening and receive the truth that you have for us from these verses in the book of Isaiah. Lord, help us understand why they were spoken, when they were spoken, and how they can be a help to us. And Lord, give us help. Give us encouragement this evening from this wonderful promise from Isaiah 40 and verse 31. Have your way in our heart and life in Jesus' name. Amen. The book of Isaiah, as many of you know, is sometimes considered a miniature Bible. There's 66 books in the Bible. There's 66 chapters in Isaiah. There's a division in our Bible between the 39 Old Testament books and the 27 New Testament books. So 39 to 40, there's a division in Isaiah between chapters 39 and 40. So it's a miniature Bible in itself. And what's been happening in Isaiah during this time that he was a prophet, Israel's divided into two kingdoms, northern kingdom and southern kingdom. The northern kingdom is referred to as Israel. The southern kingdom is referred to as Judah. And these both kingdoms have been under attack by foreign nations, by the way, because they've turned their back on God. So God has begun to punish them and begin to take his judgment, bring his judgment upon them. And when Isaiah pens the words that God gave him here in the book of Isaiah, all of the northern kingdom have been taken captive by Sennacherib and the Assyrians, and much of the southern kingdom as well had been taken. He pretty much has stripped the land bare. He would have captured Jerusalem, but if you recall, Hezekiah was the king then, and Hezekiah spread out the letter from Sennacherib before the Lord and prayed, and God gave him a deliverance there because of a godly king named Hezekiah. But Isaiah could always see, God gave him the ability as the prophet to look ahead and see in the horizon. He could see deliverance coming. Now, not just for their temporary problem, but he could see deliverance coming because a virgin will conceive and bring forth a son. Unto you a child is born, unto us a son is given. And he could see that the deliverer was going to come nearly 700 years before he did come. And so as he pens the words in Isaiah 40, you realize people reading these words from Isaiah have been going through some very, very difficult times. They've been going through some real struggles. They've been oppressed. They're having a very, very tough time. In fact, notice what they said in verse 27. Why sayest thou, O Jacob, and speakest, O Israel, my way is hid from the Lord, and my judgment is passed over from my God? You know what they were saying? They're saying, God doesn't see what's going on with me. And you know, I don't think it's just them. I think they said it, and here, several thousand years later, we still have people, when they go through troubles and they go through hard times, they think, did God forget about me? Does God not know what's going on in my life? Is he sure that he's for, has he not forgot about my situation? And God's people still can complain. And so they went to Isaiah gives them an answer. Now here's the thing. They're going through trouble. They're going through affliction. They're going through judgment from God. They don't know that's what it is. They don't understand that's what it is. They just know, I don't like my life. I don't like the way things are going. This isn't how I want to live. And they go to Isaiah and say, give me some help. Give me an answer. And the answer he gives them is not what they want to hear. You know, it's frustrating, isn't it, when you go to get advice from somebody and they don't tell you what you want to hear? Huh? And oftentimes what we do is we just keep going to other people till we get somebody to tell us what we agree with. And by the way, that's not the biblical definition of getting counsel. Okay? It's not an opinion poll, and you're around enough people, get somebody to agree with you. And so Isaiah gives them an answer, and here's your answer. He says, here's what you need to do when you're going through the trouble, when you're going through the trials, when you feel like God's hid from you. You need to wait on the Lord. Oh, that isn't what they wanted to do. Come on, tell me to do something. Tell me how to get out of this mess and tell me how to fix it. But he says, no, I want you to wait. What does it mean to wait on the Lord? It means you have to have faith in the Lord. It means you have to believe God. It means you have to trust God. It means you have to call upon the Lord and you have to wait on Him. In fact, wait in the Webster's 1828 dictionary says to stay or rest in expectation, to stop or remain stationary till the arrival of some person or event. If I'm waiting on somebody, I'm waiting for someone to show up. Well, in this case, I think Isaiah is saying, you know what you do? You just wait on God to show up. God will show up. Now, let me give you a few thoughts this evening, all right? Why do we wait on the Lord? You know, how many of you can honestly say, you just love to wait? That's what I thought. Nobody drives up to a restaurant and there's a line out the door and say, hey, there's a long line, let's eat here. Nobody says that. You've all said, hey, it's too crowded, let's go somewhere else. I want to wait here. I don't like waiting. If you think people like to wait, just next time the light turns green, sit there for a few seconds. You'll find out how much people like to wait. A lot of times when things are hard, when things are getting tough in life, I'm talking about marriage in trouble, I'm talking about financial difficulties, I'm talking about being frustrated in your job, or your health is deteriorating, and you feel like it's just slipping away from you. Life just isn't going well at all. What you don't want to be told to do is wait. You want to be told, do something. And everything in you says, I got to do something. And the answer from the prophet was, wait. Wait on the Lord. Assyrians have come in, killed their husbands, killed their wives, parents, daughters, sons. The Babylonians were now gathering and they're ready to invade the land. It wasn't looking good for Israel. And they needed some help and they needed some relief. But Isaiah simply tells them, wait. Oh, that's not what they wanted to do. And I'll guarantee you, it's never what you want to do or what I want to do. I want to do something about it. So he doesn't tell them what he wants to hear. He tells them what they need to hear. He tells them the answer that God has for them. Now I know that's not even popular today. I can tell by your response tonight. It's not real popular. I mean, I want to, if I'm hurting physically, you know what? I want God to do something about it now. If I need financial help, I need God to do something about it now. I'm having trouble in the job or trouble in the marriage or trouble at, man, I want God to do something about it now. You know, I think that commercial, you know, I want my money and I want it now. That's kind of how we are. And by the way, there's a theology out there that plays into that. Just name it and claim it. Just say what you want. Just tell God what you want. You don't ask God. You just tell God the answer. I'll tell you what. You don't tell God the answers. God already has all the answers. You don't tell God. You don't tell God what He's supposed to do. So listen. Our faith in God, our trust in God is not something we use as a tool to manipulate God to do what we want Him to do. That's not what it is. It is our reliance on God. It is the fact that I'm acknowledging God is in control of my life. And I know what He's doing. Now I want you to look at some scriptures with me tonight. Will you take your Bible and start in the book of Psalms, will you please? Psalms. David wrote much about waiting on the Lord. Look at Psalm 27, would you please? Psalm 27. Notice verse number 14. Psalm 27, verse 14. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. What will He do? He will strengthen thy heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Notice Psalm 37. Psalm 37. If you still haven't gotten to Psalm 27, just keep going to 37 right now, okay? Psalm 37, verse 7. Rest in the Lord and do what? Wait patiently for Him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger, forsake wrath, fret not thyself in any wise to do evil, for evildoers shall be cut off. But those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. Wait on the Lord. Look at verse 34, same chapter. Wait on the Lord and keep his way, and he shall exalt thee to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, thou shalt see it. Look over back to the book of Isaiah, would you please, where we were earlier. Only go to Isaiah 64. Isaiah chapter 64. Notice verse 4. Isaiah 64 and verse 4. For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard, nor perceived by the ear, neither hath the eye seen, O God, beside thee, what he hath prepared for him that waiteth for him. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Listen, can we think of some times in the Bible when not waiting on God caused some problems? You can think of some examples. I think about Abraham and Sarah. Not waiting on God's promise. Here's Hagar. Have a child with her. And he did. Boy, did that cause problems. We're still seeing those problems thousands of years later. And then it wasn't long after that, hey, the angels came and said, hey, Sarah's going to have a child. What? Huh? Oh, I wonder if they ever thought, oh, had we just waited? Maybe you think sometime in your life and you've known things, you said, boy, if I just would have waited, God would have taken care of that. How about Moses? He believes God's going to use him and put him in the position to deliver Israel out of Egypt. And he thinks he's going to do it by his strength. And he ends up killing an Egyptian and burying him in the sand. That wasn't the way God wasn't going to do it. And that wasn't the time God was going to do it. Moses had 40 years to think about that on the backside of the desert. Thinking, boy, if I'd have just waited for God's time. For God to make the choice. See, we get ourselves in trouble when we don't wait on God. When we try to answer our own questions, when we try to relieve our own hurts in life or troubles in life, we go after the quick fixes. Things that will just make us feel better. Whether it's money, whether it's pleasures, whether it's alcohol, drugs, food, success, fame, immorality. But in the long run, they don't help. They hurt. They don't make anything better. They just make it worse. And we make it worse because we refuse to wait. Wait on God. So much better to wait on the Lord. Now, back to Isaiah 40. What happens when we wait on the Lord? This is a great passage, isn't it? I love the way he said it in verse 28. I love when he says, hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard? That the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There's no searching of his understanding. He said, man, haven't you heard? Don't you know? I'm talking about God. I'm talking about the Almighty. I'm talking about the one who never slumbers. He never sleeps. He never gets weary. He never gets tired. He's all-knowing. He's omnipotent. Man, I'm talking about God, the Creator. Haven't you heard about Him? What do you think Israel felt when Isaiah said that? Yeah, we heard of Him. We're supposed to be His people. He said, you know what happens when you wait on Him? He renews your strength. You'll mount up with wings as eagles. You'll run and not be weary. You'll walk and not faint. Notice what the Lord says. He says, I'm going to give power, but I'm not giving power to the one who's standing strong. I'm giving power to the one who's wobbling on his knees. I'm giving power to the faint. As long as you think you've got it, God will let you think you've got it. He didn't say, I'm going to give power. Verse 29, I'm not giving power to the strong. I'm giving power to the faint. He didn't say that them that have might, I'll increase their might. He's saying no to them who have no might, I'll increase your strength. When somebody finally says, I don't think I can take it anymore. I don't think I can handle this anymore. Well, hallelujah. That's where God wanted you to get. Because He wants to help you to handle it. He wants to give you the strength to do it. To those who have no might, I'll increase their strength. The Lord said, you look inside yourself and you can't muster the strength to deal with it. You can't muster the ability to handle it. Then God says, I'll increase your strength. Better than the lady who's fallen and says, I can't get up. God doesn't just help you up. He gives you the strength to keep you from falling down again. You understand? He's not just helping you up. He's going to give you what you need to make you stronger. He'll help you not to have to stumble again. He gives power to the faint. And to those who are weak, He increases strength. You ever feel like you got no more ability in you to resist the enemy? You got no more ability in you to try to work on your problem or solve your situation? That's when God will step in. That's where God wants you to wait upon Him. Your body gets tired, remember His strength. Your mind gets weary, remember His strength. He gives strength to the faint. God never faints. God never grows weary. God never is too tired. In fact, He never sleeps. He's always ready to help and always to give strength. Now, let me give you some practical things about why we wait on God. We wait on God to receive clear direction for our life. You know, we had our lesson on prayer during the 5:30 class tonight. Is there anything that you don't have to pray about? No. In everything by prayer and supplication. So what should I pray about? Everything. Is there anything I don't need to talk to God about? Anything say, God, I got this. Huh? If you say that to God, He may let you have that. No, waiting on Him, listening to Him, talking to Him. If He'll number the hairs on our head and notice the sparrow that falls from to the earth, listen, He's concerned about the details of our life. He notices the details of our life. And so He'll give us the direction that we need. That's why we wait on Him. We trust in Him. We call upon Him. We have faith in Him. He'll make the way clear if we wait. When you're never sure what to do or what direction to go, wait till God makes it clear. Number two, we wait on God to keep in step with God's timing. Oftentimes, listen, what we want may be exactly what God wants us to have, but it's not the time for us to have it. He's waiting for the proper time. And so God may, listen, there's not only the right thing to have or the right thing to do, there's a right time to do it. And we want to have the right timing in it. The Bible even says in Galatians 4:4, when it comes to sending Jesus into the earth, that in the fullness of time, God sent forth His Son. He was waiting for the proper time. Now, yeah, how many of you, now, just be honest, okay, you're in church. hope you're honest everywhere, but if you were God, you would have had Jesus come back already and wrap this thing up. Yeah, okay. Being honest, okay? I mean, it'd have been over a while ago, okay? If we were God, we'd have said, Son, go get your bride. Let's take this care of this thing. But why hasn't He come? Because He decided it's not time yet. His time is not my time. I have to make sure that I'm on His timetable, not on my timetable. So I want to make sure I have God's timing. Number three, I wait on the Lord because it allows God the proper time to prepare me for His answer. Sometimes we're like little kids that want something, and we know that they're not ready for that yet. How many of you, when you were, probably 14, maybe 13, 14, 15, you were ready to drive a car? Yeah. You want to drive? Come on. Guess what? Not time for you to drive the car yet. You want it, and you want a car. It's not time to drive the car yet. I chuckled a little bit. There's a family who we knew in the church. We were up in North Canton, and their teenage son just got a car. I mean, just days before we had one of the first snows back in December. And she put a picture up on Facebook as he wrapped it around a pole. He was fine. Airbag deployed, though, and messed the car up. I can handle this. I'm ready to go. It's snow. That's nothing. Yeah. Like drivers in Columbus, you know. But, you know, God sometimes has to prepare us so we're ready to receive what He wants to give to us. We're not ready for it yet. You know, I think about that when I think about the brother Xavier was saying. He went back on our server from several years ago, and he's looking through sermons and such, and he would see a sermon by Brother Moreland. He said, oh man, that was 4 years ago. I ought to listen to that one, you know. And how many of you know Brother Moreland sounded a lot different preaching 4 years ago than he does now? Huh? You notice that? Yeah. What's happened? God is preparing him for the work that He asked for him to do. And by the way, that's what deputation does for the missionary. You say, oh, they're just raising support. That's part of it. That's not the main thing. God can bring the support anytime He wants. You know what He's doing? He's preparing the vessels. He's preparing the vessels to be used. He's preparing them to do the work that He has for them to do. So He's preparing us for His answer. And then, number four, we wait on the Lord to strengthen our faith in Him. To strengthen our faith in Him. I'm pretty sure Abraham learned to trust God. Pretty sure he learned that I don't get ahead of the Lord. And he has to learn to have faith in Him. God comes through on His promises. Can I help you? It's never over till God says it's over. We give up on our prayers way too easy. We give up on our prayers way too easy. The Bible, remember, importunity got the man's prayers answered. Constant begging. Not willing to, and he just continued to believe that God would answer. Hey, do you think it strengthened Mary and Martha's faith that Jesus came and brought their brother back from the dead? I mean, I wonder if they ever thought when Lazarus started getting sick the next time. Hey, it's all right. If he dies, we'll call Jesus. It's okay, you know. I don't know if they thought that or not, but I'm pretty sure they could have believed that. I would have thought that. I said, hey, we'll just call Jesus. He'll bring him back again. It's all right. Their faith would have been that strong and that confidence in him. And that's the way it ought to be for us. Ought to have that. It ought to strengthen our faith to see God work. And we wait on God, and he strengthens our faith as he answers our prayer. Number five, we allow God to, when we wait on the Lord, we allow God to check our motives and reveal our true desires. God said in the book of James that sometimes we ask and we have not because we ask amiss to consume it upon our lusts. In other words, God says, I may want to give you what you're asking, but I can't give it to you because I know you're asking for it for the wrong reasons. You have selfish motives. God knows the thoughts and intents of our heart. In fact, he knows our heart better than we know our heart. And so sometimes when we're waiting and we're waiting on the answer and it's not coming, it may be that God says, hey, why don't you let me search your heart and point out to you where I think you're asking for this for the wrong reasons. And he sifts through our motives. See, here's the thing, and I said this, and I'll probably blow your mind here, but I said this in the prayer class tonight. The most everybody's always heard, there's three answers to prayer. Yes, no, and wait. Okay? Now, there's obviously waiting on the Lord. But you're waiting and you're continuing to ask. You're continuing to ask what you're... You know, this idea, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall. Knock and it shall be. Next verse. Everyone that asketh, receiveth. To him that seeketh, he shall find. And to him that knocks, it shall be opened unto him. Where's no and wait a while on those? It isn't there. You know why we got that idea that it's no and wait a while? Because we stopped asking. We didn't let God show us where our motives were wrong, so he couldn't give it to us. We don't say, my motives were wrong. I was asking for the wrong reasons. We say, well, I asked God for that, but he said no. We blame God. The problem couldn't be with me. Couldn't be on my end. Has to be God's. Hey, what he taught in Luke 11 there was that man who came at midnight. I need three loaves. A friend's coming his journey. You got to help me. Guy opens the window. I'm in bed. All my family's in bed. Get out of here. Three loaves. I need three loaves. My iPad doesn't like when I pound like that. Says, I need three loaves. Help me. I told you, we're in bed. Get out of here. I told my 5:30 class, I know what happened, Brother Lindemann. They all slept together, you know. His wife said, if we're going to get any sleep tonight, get up and give that guy some bread. That's in the Greek somewhere, but it's, I don't know where, but that's what I think happened. But you know what? God didn't say, remember, he said he didn't get up and give it to him because he's his friend. He got up and gave it to him because of his importunity, his constant begging. He finally realized this guy isn't going away until I give him what he wants. You ever prayed like that? You ever waited on God like that? And had that persistency with God? No, we go a day, 2 days, 3 days, maybe a week, and then we say, well, must be no. and to cover up our lack of importunity and our lack of persistence and our lack of willing to wait on God, we came up with a cute little thing that says, well, sometimes God says yes, sometimes God says no, and sometimes God says wait, and that's just the way it is. So just roll the dice when you pray and hope you get one of them. You okay? You all right? I can tell some of you are looking at me like, whoa. He's revealing to it, revealing our desires. He wants us maybe to cleanse our heart of impure motives, of why we want him to answer the prayer. Waiting on the Lord. You know, you're not going to get through life without some struggles. It doesn't happen. Don't let the devil ever tell you, don't allow him to have you look at somebody else and say, yeah, if I just had their life. You have no idea what they're dealing with. I've told you so many times, if we all brought our life's troubles up and laid them on the altar and you saw what everybody else was going through, you know what you'd do? You'd come pick your own up and say, I think I'll just keep what I have. I'll just keep what I have. I mean that. You have no idea. Sometimes I can't say sometimes, but I know what some people are going through. And someone will say, well, if I was like them, boy, I just wish I had their life. And boy, I think to myself, no, you don't. No, you don't. You don't know what they're dealing with. You know what they're going through. So don't, when you, don't look for things outside of you and outside in this world to bring you satisfaction, to bring you happiness, to bring you contentment, to bring you satisfaction. You'll always be disappointed. The things of the world will always disappoint you. They never promise what Satan promises. You'll be on a roller coaster, up and down, up and down. Hey, I feel good today. Man, I'm in a good mood. And the next day you call somebody up and they say, I don't know, I think I'm better off dead. And they're just riding the roller coaster. People sometimes, they wait on the Lord. Wait patiently for him. One thing I've discovered, God's never in a hurry. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, for he trusteth in thee. Isaiah 26:3. Again, from Isaiah. To people that were going through tough times. Wait on the Lord. Wait for light to come in the darkness. Wait for direction to come in the difficulty. Wait for power to come in the weakness. Wait for wisdom to come in trials. Wait for comfort to come in sorrow. But wait on the Lord. You know why? They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They'll walk and not faint. If you rely on your own strength, if you rely on your own power, he says, even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. You think you can do it, God will let you go at it until you fall flat on your face. And you learn to wait on the Lord. And he'll renew your strength. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach me, Lord, teach me, Lord, to wait. If you can learn that song, you memorize the verse. It'll help you. Wait upon the Lord. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the wonderful promise of Isaiah. Lord, I know, I understand. It's not always what I want to do when there's problems or difficulties. Kind of want to roll up your sleeves and or get out the pen and paper and you figure out what do I need to do. And Lord, show us tonight what we need to do is wait on you, to trust you, to have faith in you, to wait on the Lord until you make the way clear as to what you would have us to do, to wait for God to show up. And I don't know who needed it tonight or how many needed it, but I know I needed it. And Lord, I thank you for the wonderful promise of Isaiah 40 and verse 31. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a moment. How many people here tonight would say, "Preacher, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart tonight. Going through some things in my life, going through some situations. I need to wait on the Lord. That's what I need to do. Been trying to do it on my own or figure it out on my own, trying to do some things in my own power and my own strength, and what I need to do is realize I'm weak. I need Him. I'm going to wait on God to show up. Because then you'll soar like the eagle. You'll run and not get weary. You'll walk and not faint." I wonder how many folks here tonight would say, "Preacher, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart tonight. Here's my hand. Pray for me this evening." Amen. Amen. That's good. Thank you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray. We'll have our invitation. God has spoken to you. Now, speak to Him. Respond to Him tonight. What the Spirit of God has spoken to your heart about. Wait on the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts tonight. Thank you for the wonderful promise you give us. If we'll just look to you, wait upon you, you will renew our strength. We need you tonight, Lord. Many people in this room need you in the situation they're in. So help us as we look to you, put our faith in you, put our trust in you, and wait upon you. Have your way in every heart and life, please, during this invitation. I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob will sing the invitation hymn. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this evening, please.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting He passed, and we follow Him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, He promised. Believe Him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, His perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the theme
and sing that chorus.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Go ahead and be seated for a minute, would you? Brother Jarvis, today's his birthday, folks. The youngest 70-year-old that you know. I'll guarantee it. Guarantee it. He said it, he told us today at lunch he doesn't feel a day over 69. And I want to take just a couple minutes, and here's what I want to do. I just want you to, you to say one word about Jack Jarvis, okay, for his birthday. Just, what do you think? Jack Jarvis, one word, okay? Right here. Inspirational. Jeanette? Energetic. Andy? Faith. Steadfast, encouraging, servant. Pete?
Goodwill.
That's two words. Goodwill. Hyphenated. We'll give you a hyphenation there, all right? Goodwill. All right. Leland?
Helper.
Emma? Funny. Okay. Yes. Cynthia? Missionary. Isaac? Good stories. That's two words too, but we'll let you go with that since you're in the family, all right? Tanya. Wonderful. Amen. Danny.
Believer.
Chuck.
Discernment.
Bob.
Godly.
Leanne.
Example.
Wow. It's a great testimony, Brother Jack. Praise the Lord. So glad that the Lord has allowed them to be with us for this period of time. You've been a great, as you can tell, you've been a great, had a great impact in our church. And we love you tonight and want to say happy birthday to you. We're not just going to sing to you. We have a cake and some ice cream next door for you. And I think they've got 70 balloons blown up. So why don't you come on up? We'll give you a card and let everybody sing happy birthday to you. I know you love this kind of stuff, you know, but not. But we sure appreciate you, Brother Jack. Thank you so much for all you do for us, and happy birthday to you. Amen. Let's sing to him, all right? We won't sing Sweeter as the Years Go By with that, all right? We won't do that. Amen. All right. Now, you're welcome to stay. If you can, understand, but if you can stay and enjoy the fellowship and wish him happy birthday personally, that'd be great. And we'll stand up, we'll pray, and sing our song of dismissal, and we'll head over to the fellowship hall, all right? Father, thank you for a wonderful day today. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord. Thank you for our church family, and thank you, Lord, for decisions that were made for you throughout the day today. Lord, we thank you for Brother Jarvis and the impact he's had in our lives, Lord. Thank you for his testimony. Thank you for his love for you. Thank you for Sherry and the ministry, Lord, that you've given to them. Pray you'll continue to guide them and use them for your honor and glory. Lord, bless our fellowship together over the cake and the ice cream, and then, Lord, dismiss us and Father, make us mindful that you're going with us, and that I pray that we'll be mindful of your presence and we'll please you in all we do this week. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. All right. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing it. And we'll see you next door. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You're dismissed.